the lowest hell. The guilty pair, bowed down with care, God gave his Son to win. His erring child, he reconciled, and pardoned from his sin. It shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song. When years of time shall pass away, and earthly thrones and kingdoms fail, when men who and hills and mountains frail, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong, redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints and song. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' song.
Let us just bow in prayer before we start off. Lord in heaven, again we beseech thy throne. We're not worthy to come before thy throne, but because of your grace, you told us to come boldly. And we ask during this next hour that you would give us strength, wisdom, to help make thy word simple, so that we might all accept you and your atonement for our lost souls. Please, Lord, help us and forgive us, we ask. For Jesus' sake, amen. Now, I want Elder Stump just to close his ears one more time. Because when I see you, and I see the scriptures, I think about him. For the last 3 or 4 months, I've been reading carefully the words of Jesus in Matthew 23 and 24 and 25 and 26 and 27. And when I got to Matthew 25, something shocking jumped out at me. The 10 virgins. And the 10 virgins, all 5 were wise and 5 were foolish. But all of them went to sleep. And Mrs. White says that that represents the church, the corporate church. All of them were asleep. But then it went on to say that at midnight, somebody cried out, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh." Now, if the church was asleep, who was it that called out? Folks like Stump. You see, the corporate church is all involved in whatever it's involved in, and it is sleep, she says. But you have watchmen on the walls like Stump that warn us. We're busy, we're working, we're doing this, we're doing that. And this man's life is just caught up in warning us. He's a watchman on the wall warning us from the wiles of the devil. I personally appreciate it. Now, this whole idea of the atonement. Now, for the last several months, he's been talking about the atonement, the blood of Christ, the sanctuary, Jesus Christ. So what I did, I went and took all of those the messages in the thing, and I had them printed. And I went through all of it. I'm going through it carefully, underlining and writing down and writing down. Now, he's the one who dug all this out. And I told you last night, I don't know how and when he has the time to do all these things, but he researches. He gets to the root words. He makes it clear, makes it plain. He illustrates something that we don't see. And so when you get a chance, read this. It really is important to read. Amen. The atonement, the blood of Jesus, and the sacrifice, importance of the sanctuary. So I just, thank you. Thank you for all the work that you do in trying to show us what the Lord has for us in these last days. Now, I ask the Lord, just Lord help me, to make simple this plan that you have given us. And when you read the Bible, it's there. But like I showed you that cow last night, unless somebody shows you, you won't see it. And you're looking at it all the time. So when you look at the whole plan of salvation, the Lord wanted to show us the process that he goes through in getting rid of our sin and in saving us. And he illustrates this in the sanctuary. Old Testament, New Testament. He talks about the sanctuary, the holy place, the most holy place, the importance of the holy place, the importance of the most holy place. He talks about the high priest. He talks about the Day of Atonement, all in the process of the sanctuary. Now, as I'm looking at this and reading this, something jumps out at me that frightens me and makes me fearful and scares me, of which I'm going to read to you. Let's go to Leviticus. Leviticus, and I'm going to try to be patient with myself and explain this the way the Lord has given me or showed me. And I told you every sermon that I preach now, I make sure that I get my own message. All right? Now, Leviticus 23 and verse 27. Now, in the process of the sanctuary, there's the holy place, the most holy place, then the Day of Atonement, and all of these phases have an important work to do that Jesus does. And then when it comes down to the Day of Atonement, we have something to do, or the people had something to do on that day along with the high priest.
That's right.
See, there are two phases. Now, verse 26, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, also on the 10th day of the 7th month, yes, there shall be a Day of Atonement. It shall be a holy convocation unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls, and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And Sister Hope gave a tremendous example of all this yesterday in talking about the Day of Atonement. And listen, verse 28, and ye shall do no work in that same day. For it is a Day of Atonement, he keeps saying Day of Atonement, to make an atonement for you before the Lord your God. And here's the phrase that scared me. See? Now he says, now the high priest is in the sanctuary. Now this is on earth now. See? Now we as Adventists believe that there's no sanctuary on earth, so this applies to the antitypical day in heaven. Now, while Jesus, the high priest, was on earth, don't do no work, because work won't do you no good on that day. Afflict your souls, and listen to what it says. Verse 29, for whosoever shall be that shall not be afflicted in the same day, he shall be cut off from among his people. In other words, separated, cut off, put away. If you don't afflict your soul, or if you're not in tune with the high priest on earth who's in the sanctuary. Now get the picture here. On the Day of Atonement, one day a year, atonement means run together with, united. The high priest goes into that most holy place before God now. And while he's in there before God, the people were on the outside of that most holy place. Are you listening? Now, while the high priest was in there before God, the people on the outside were basically kind of fearful because they wanted to make sure that the high priest represented them in the most holy place before, while he was in there with the Father. So they didn't work. There was no need to work. They were afraid, but they were faithful. Lord, please accept my pardon, my sins that were in the holy place that were transferred to the most holy place. Lord, please have mercy. Now, if there was sin in the camp while the high priest was in the most holy place, then what happened? What happened? They died. See, the point is to me that while the high priest on earth was in there before the Father, you don't cut up, act a fool, and be unlike God while he's in there taking the time to represent you and your sins before the Father.
Amen.
Now that thing stuck with me and sticks with me. Now you transfer the earthly practice of that holy place over into heaven. Now we understand since 1844, that's where Jesus has been in the most holy place before the Father.
That's right.
Now, I'm on earth. I'm on earth. He's up there. And he's telling his Father, look, all these folk, they've asked me for pardon. They've confessed their sins. I've forgiven them their sins. Now, he's in the most holy place up there. And we're down here. Now, we're down here now. And we just wandering around, cutting up, disobeying, acting crazy, got hatred, don't love nobody, don't worry about them, just doing whatever we want to do. Now, he's up there. Now, that's not going to happen. And we're struggling. Oh, we got problems. Oh, we got sin. Oh, we got worry. Now, the sad part about it is the corporate church comes along and says, there's no way for you to be without sin. You're going to always sin. And you're going to always sin. The Lord is forgiving. He'll always forgive. And he will. But it relaxes you to think that you can just keep on doing what you're doing, and he's going to be up there forgiving. Now, the one thing about it, he ain't going to lie. He's not going to tell his father that you're all right if you're not all right down here.
That's right.
Now, we need to get that through our heads. He's not going to lie for me up there when he's up there representing my sins that I've asked him to take, and he's been faithful and just to forgive me of. So unless what he says up there agrees with me down here, I could be cut off. But that's the thing that scared me. Now, it don't scare me no more because I understand it. See, with humps, with Stump's presentations in his adult bit, he helps me, see? Now, if you don't read it and get it, we won't really get help you. See, the point is with us today, since we're in the antitypical day of the atonement, how do we act down here while he's in before his father up there asking him to forgive us and we keep on doing what we're doing? Not going to happen. Now listen. This is what White says. Now, this is from the 1888 version of the Great Controversy. The subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God, implying we don't get it. Looking at the sanctuary, normally we see it, and we've been reading about it, I've been preaching about it, and they're telling the people all about it in general, but I didn't completely understand it. And she says, we ought to clearly understand by the people of God. Now, I'm calling myself the people of God. So I need to clearly understand it. All need a knowledge for themselves of the position and work of their high priest. Now, it's all right for me to have an understanding, but she says, you as a person need it. Wow. Now, I delved in it for me, and just because I'm a preacher, you know, I'll tell you what I found, and that's what I'm doing today. But you need to sit down with your Bible and your spirit of prophecy, and with the help of what Stump put in the paper, and understand the judgment and the investigative judgment in the sanctuary for yourself.
Amen.
Not for somebody else, for yourself. Otherwise, it will be impossible for them to exercise the faith essential at this time or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. Now, what I've learned is also that the biggest work that Jesus tried for 50 years to show me that the most important thing that God wants and Jesus wanted is for me to have complete faith and trust in him. But now every time you turn around, somebody is trying to tell me what I should do or what I ought to do and what I got to do and what I can't do. Jesus is interested in my faith. And she makes it clear, when you understand the position of Jesus, your high priest, in the most holy place, what you need to understand is that strengthens your faith. And faith is what you have to have, not just knowing, but faith, real faith. We are to bear testimony of the great truths which God has committed to us. But that falls on deaf ears. We are to bear testimony. The sanctuary in heaven is the very center of Christ's work in our behalf of men. Amen. Wait a minute now. If that's the center of my salvation, then I better know something about it.
Amen.
Now, if my decision for me going to heaven or hell, let's say, weighs on the brethren downtown, and I got a trial and a case downtown, and I know my name is coming up downtown, I'm going to be outside the town having fun and cutting the fool and acting up, and my name is down there being talked about, and either I go to heaven or hell, and they're going to decide it, and I don't know nothing about it, I ain't clear on it. What is the lawyer, the priest going to say? I don't know what he's going to say. What am I making him say? What am I talking to him about? Don't make sense to me. It is of uttermost importance that all who receive the light, both old and young, should thoroughly investigate these subjects.
Amen.
Now, to me, this is what Dr. Stump has done. He's thoroughly investigated it, dug into the words, showed you the meaning, so that you might understand. He done really made it simple in these pages here. The importance of Jesus and his blood on the Day of Atonement. Now, most Seventh-day Adventists, to me, they don't really talk about it. You don't hear nothing about it. Preachers don't preach about it. So you don't get it. Now, you've heard about it in the Bible, but you don't get it. The intercession of Christ in man's behalf in the sanctuary above is as essential to the plan of salvation as was his death on the cross.
Amen. That's right.
Oh, we know about his death, which is important. Oh, about his life, we know that's important. But just as important is the role Jesus is playing in heaven, in the sanctuary up there. Now, if there's a problem, since there's a problem with me, you see, I'm preacher always preaching to myself. If there's a problem with this process with me, I want to sit down and figure out how it is that I can live down here on this earth without sin when he's representing me up there and he don't want no sin in me down here.
Amen.
I can't listen to nobody else, but I'm going to listen to Jesus. Are you listening to me? So I'm concerned about that. So I go to my Bible, and here's what I find. So I'm going to read them to you now. Now, of all the guys, Paul got it. I mean, Apostle Paul had it. And, you know, from my experience, it seems like you have to have some kind of supernatural, out of the way, unusual, ordinary circumstance to knock you upside your head before you get it. See, now all along I'm preaching, and all along I'm going up and down the road. All I'm down, I'm going here. All I'm down the road, I'm going to the churches. All I'm going here. I'm doing all this stuff. And then all of a sudden, I have a stroke. And I say, Lord, you know, I've been doing all this thing for all these years. I don't want to fool around here and be lost. So I took my Bible, and I said, I'm going to read this Bible unlike I've ever read it before. Amen. And I think I've told you that when you read the Bible and let it tell you what it says, you'll discover that it says differently than what you heard that it said, or said differently than what they told you it said. Paul the same way. He read the Bible. He's studying the Bible. Oh, he's working for the Lord. He's going around killing the Christians. I mean, he's whipping them. He's putting them in jail. And all of a sudden, he has an experience. something like hit him in his head and knocked him off his horse. Oh, Lord, have mercy. What do you want me to do? See, now that experience helped them to understand what he didn't see. Like I told you last night, you're looking at all this, but you don't see. You're not understanding what the miracles of God are trying to say about his kingdom. 1 Corinthians 2:14. I'm going to read them to you. You can just write them down when you get home. 1 Corinthians 2:14 and then verse 16. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit, for they are foolishness unto them. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So when you talk about the spirituality of Jesus being your high priest, that's spiritual talk. Because you don't talk about no high priest normally down here, and you don't understand all about no high priest. Oh, you don't know. Don't bother with that. You want to know what the pastor said. You're concerned about the conference. You're concerned about the general conference, what it's doing. Spiritual stuff, spiritual things, things of the Spirit, things of God. Verse 16, for who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Amen. Now listen at this. The Lord showed me that the whole plan of salvation is really, really simple. Because the Lord's Spirit works on your head, on your brain, in your mind. In other words, when you were born, all of us were born physically. And then the Spirit, which was born with you, Jesus said, the light is every man that comes into the world. The Spirit is there too. Now the Spirit is what God works on, something that you can't see with your eyes, something that you can't hear with your natural ears. But he works on that side of you that only he works on. And when you decide, that's the critical point, your decision. When he told Nicodemus that you must convert, stop listening to your flesh and you start listening to the Spirit. You convert. And when you convert, Jesus comes and he fills that spot in your brain. You decide to follow him. Every day that you live, there's decision that you made. Sometimes they call it the heart, because the heart is at the center of the body, but the heart means your brain or your mind. Jesus wants to work on your mind.
Amen.
Now that's where he's at, working on your brain. Just give me your mind. Trust me. Turn yourself deliberately over to me in your mind. Now you can't see nothing else beyond that if you don't give me your mind. Now I'm reading again now. 1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you? Who? You done heard that text. I preached that text 1,000 times. What do you mean the Holy Spirit is in my body? Now, the reason why I ain't thought nothing about it, because I'm listening to my flesh. I don't see no Spirit in me. You don't see no Spirit in me. You can't see it with your eyes. But Paul said, according to Jesus, that the Holy Spirit lives in your body if you choose in your head to let him live there. Lord, I want you in my heart, in my head, in my body, and you control what I do. See, what's in your mind controls what you do. And he says, I want to live in you. I want you to get this now. I'm going to take my time with it. He wants to live in you. Now, you can't see it. Jesus told Nicodemus. Now, you can't see, after you convert, me living in you. But you can see the evidence of it. And the example he said, just like you can't see the trees that the wind is blowing. You see the tree moving, but you don't see what's moving it. So when the Spirit is living in your head, you can't see in your head, you can't see in mine. But you can see evidence that he's in me. Now I'm going to read it a little more now. So the Holy Spirit is in me, dwelling in my mind, because I've chosen to let him lead me. Now, if you don't choose, the flesh side is going to control you, and the devil is going to control your flesh. What you see, oh boy, that looks good. Oh, that's good. Oh boy, what a man, that's pretty. I like that. That's flesh. See, the Spirit controls the things of the Spirit. And your flesh controls the things of your flesh. And the devil controls your flesh. Now, wait, I ain't through yet. 2 Corinthians 6:16. And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. Now, did you get that? Your body, if you decide to let Jesus lead you, you become a living temple that people can see. And the way they see it is the evidence. See? Which temple ye are? No, I'm sorry. For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, and I will be their God, and walk in them. I will be their God, and they will be my people. So when a person decides to let Jesus' Spirit live in him, then the person will see that there's evidence that he's in there by the way they think. They don't think different, like they think different than the person living by the flesh. Hold on. Now, this idea was even in the Old Testament. Ezekiel 36:26-27. A new heart also I will give you. In other words, a new mind. And a new spirit. See, now the old spirit, which was from the flesh, God said, I'm going to give you a new spirit. Something you ain't got because you never convert. If you don't convert, you got the old spirit. I will give you a new heart, also give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. There is that term again, that phrase, putting something within you. I will take away your stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a new heart of flesh. And I will put what? My spirit within you. See, he keeps talking about the same phrase. I want to live in you. I want to be in you. I want to be in you. I want to abide with you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my commandments and do them. See, we always put the cart before the horse. In other words, when the Spirit of God, you could let him control your head, your brain, what Jesus puts in you will be the ability and the mind to obey his commands. See, you ain't got to try to do it. You do it automatically. Now, I want you to get that now. See, in other words, oh, I got to do this. Oh, I got to pass out something. Oh, I got to belong to this church. Oh, I got to go to this meeting. See, and what I've learned is the devil has been as slick as anything in this world. He has us all wrapped up in what we do. Oh, it's just so important. Oh, we got to go to the church. We got to belong here. The pastor said we got to do this here. And it's not only among Adventists, but it's everywhere. Did you see the documentary on Muhammad Ali's death? Greatest man there was. Everybody loved Muhammad. Everybody wanted to be like Muhammad. And then they sat down and interviewed him and his wife. And his wife said, the reason why he did what he did in the end, he wanted to make sure that everything that he did helped him to be saved. So he gave out money. He gave out tickets. He went around doing good. Now, all that's fine. But my Bible tells me you ain't gonna have no eternal life without Jesus.
That's right.
See? So the devil doesn't fool him to think that made him think that what he did would help him be saved. But see, what he did left out Jesus.
That's right.
See, that's how we are. That's how the devil makes us all think that we can get to heaven without Jesus. Oh, if I just belong to the Seventh-day Adventist Church and I ain't changed nothing, but just belong in. Now, isn't that right?
That's right.
Now, listen, I can stand here and tell you. Now, I didn't do it deliberately. I did it ignorantly until my eyes came open. Amen. See, my goal was, as a practicing minister of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, they put it in our heads that your success as a preacher would be in baptizing people. They give you all the skills, even gave you a little money, gave you all the tools. We bought a tent. They bought chairs. We wanted to make Seventh-day Adventists out of people. And I had an unconscious thing that if a person just belonged to the church, he was saved. And my goal was to just fill up the church everywhere I went. Fill up the church. And I thought filling up the church meant that I was successful. Now, to the eyes who that were not of God, like I read you, that was successful. But to the eyes of the Lord and his spirit, that may not have been, because the people that came in did not have Jesus in them. Now, how do I know that? So you're trying to judge him now. No, I ain't judging. I'm just looking at the evidence. Because some come in, and they didn't like what they saw and what they heard and how the people treated them, and so they left. So the salvation was not in belonging to my church. Is that clear?
Yes,
boy, John 14:16. Now, this is Jesus now. Now, all I read about Paul, I read about Ezekiel, is Jesus now. I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever.
Amen.
Now, this is Jesus talking to his disciples. He said, now, listen, folks, I'm going to send you somebody else from my Father. My Father's going to give you somebody else, and he's going to comfort you and abide with you. Not only live in you, but he's going to abide outside. Now, there's something controlling my brain that I listen to that is Jesus in there, and then something on the outside of me that's Jesus helping me abide with me, I ain't got nothing to worry about. See how simple this thing is? Wait a minute, I ain't through. Verse 17. For the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth in you, and shall be in you.
With you.
And shall be in you. In other words, he'll be in you and with you.
That's right.
How can you go wrong?
Amen.
Now just tell me, how can you go wrong? Now I'm down here now, remember now. I need help, because he ain't going to represent me up there while I'm sitting down here. So he tells the disciples that while when I go back to my Father and represent you up there, I'm going to leave you a spirit down here that's going to be in your head that will help and control you if you listen to it. And I'm going to be and abide with you. So it's a guarantee if you listen to the Spirit, you're going to be like Jesus was. Hold it now. Philippians 2, 5 and 13. Let this mind be in you. There it is again. Let this mind, in other words, allow the Spirit of God to control your brain. Don't listen to your flesh. Listen to the Spirit. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. So the invitation to me is clear. Unless the Spirit controls me, then I can't be represented properly by God in heaven. Now let me give you another text that just comes to my mind while I was sitting in the chair. 1 John. 1 John, and I think it's chapter 3. 1 John 3. 1 John 3. Now listen to this. And this is what really helps me out. 1 John 3, and I'm going to tell you what I'm going to read. 1 John. 1 John 3. 1 John 3, 4 first. For whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law. For ye know this, we know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Now, Jesus came here to take away my sins. So I've given him my sins. I've asked for forgiveness. He asked to help me overcome, and I've accepted him by faith. And he says, and ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Whosoever abideth that word, for abideth in him, sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Whosoever abideth in Jesus does not practice or keep on sinning because he's in you. Amen. So when you keep talking about you can't overcome and you can't stop sinning, you're telling a lie. If Jesus is not in you. If Jesus is in you, you cannot do it. You cannot practice it. See, Jesus made it possible for us to be able to stand on this earth and for him to represent us up there. He made that possible. He said, I'm going to leave here now, and I'm going to send you help inside of you and outside of you if you just listen at me. So what for? The whole point is, he wants to be one. What is atonement? Being one. Being one. Now, wait, let me finish. Now, I ain't finished reading to you yet. Let's go. Now, wait. Let me read this here. Now, take your Bible. I'm going to read this out of another translation. But I'm reading Colossians 1, 24 through... I'm going to stop. Colossians. Now listen to this now. See, I told you about a mystery and how the Lord shows us a mystery by examples. See? Now this whole thing that I've read to you about Jesus being in you and with you and abiding with you and all that, you don't hear that. We don't get that. I'm reading it out of another translation so it'll smoothly go into your head. Remember, I'm out after understanding, so I want you to understand. I am glad when I suffer for you in my body, for I am participating in the suffering of Christ that continue for his body, the church. God has given me the responsibility of serving his church by proclaiming the entire message to you. What do you mean by entire? In other words, they didn't get it all. I didn't get it all. I got some of it, but I didn't get it all. His message was kept secret for centuries and generations past. But now it has been revealed to his people. So there's some part of the plan that was kept secret. secret from me. Now, I saw it, but I didn't see it. I listened to it, but I didn't hear it. You see, just like most of us. Now listen, for God wanted them to know that the riches and glory of Christ are for the Gentiles too. And this is the secret. Christ lives in you. The secret that has been blocked out for generations was not only for Jews, but for Gentiles. This was the secret that God wanted to live in us through Christ. He had been proclaiming that. Amen. So in the atonement, it's possible for a person to be complete and whole, not because of what you did, but because of Christ living in you, man. Amen. Oh, that thing is simple to me now. You see, like I told you last night about that cow, I didn't see it. And this gives us assurance of his glory. Verse 28. So we tell others about Christ, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all the wisdom God has given us. We want to present them to God perfect in their relationship with Christ. That's why I struggle so hard, depending upon Christ's mighty power that works within me. There's that phrase, works within me, with all of his might, because of the power of Christ that was working with him. He wanted to show people how important it was for them to accept in their head the Spirit of Christ who will abide with them and in them so that they might be complete. Amen. Were they absolutely perfect? No. But they were perfect in the expression of Jesus Christ by faith. Now that's simple. Now listen, one more thing. Go to the book of John. St. John, again. St. John, chapter 17. Now, this idea was so strong with Jesus. St. John 17. St. John 17. And verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. Jesus always starts that phrase off. I tell you the truth. And he wasn't lying. It is expedient for you that I go away, for I will go not away. But if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. Now he's gone. Jesus left. I'm sorry. 16, I'm sorry. Yeah, yeah. What did I tell you? I'm sorry, right. I read that already. John 17, yeah, right. 17, verse 9. 17:9. See, the devil don't want me to give you that from Jesus. I pray for them, and I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me. For they are thine, and all thine are mine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be what?
One.
Wait a minute, they may be what?
One.
What does atonement mean?
One.
Jesus said, I'm going to supply everything to you on this earth that will help you to be one with me and my Father. Now, I don't see how you can beat that. I'm going to live in you. I'm going to live around you. I'm going to control you if you listen to what I tell you in your head. See, everything that you do, you have to decide to do it. I don't care what it is. And that spirit that's in your head, if you decide to follow Jesus, will tell you. I want to go to the store. Go and buy this. Your spirit tell you, now you don't get that. But you don't listen to it. Most of us don't. I'm going to buy this. I think I need that. I'm going to buy this dress. I'm going to go here. I'm going to go there. We don't listen to the spirit. We do what the flesh wants. But Jesus has supplied what everything we need to be properly represented on the Day of Atonement in heaven with his Father.
Amen.
Now, I don't see how in the world we can not miss that. It's right here before me. Hold it, I ain't through reading yet. Verse 20. Neither pray I thee this alone, for them also which shall believe on me through their word. For they all may be what? As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they may also be what?
One.
In us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Amen. Now this is Jesus himself talking. He says, oneness is what my Father wants. Now I'm going to put myself through my spirit in them. I'm going to abide with them so that when you look at those who accept this plan, all of us will be one. That's what the atonement is, to make us one, united with the Father and with the Son. And he said, because we do that, you will glorify me. Jesus will be honored and praised and glorified and hallowed everywhere. Amen. He is the crowning act of our salvation.
Amen.
Lord, how can we miss that? Now, in conclusion, we all got sidetracked because the leaders of the church decided that's an unusual message, and therefore we wanted to be like the world. So we're going to let that message, put it on the side, ain't going to talk about it, ain't going to acknowledge it. We're going to the seminary, and we're going to teach all of our ministers that ain't even so. Now you say, how do you know that? See, I'm one of the preachers that they sent to the seminary. And I couldn't understand how the teacher at the seminary could go against the sanctuary, the atonement, and the high priest of Christ. Now see, here going back to Stump. Stump puts in his newsletter letters that was written to certain ministers back there then that couldn't understand how the thing had changed. See, the Lord is wonderful. The Lord is wonderful. See, back there then, the ministers were confused because they'd been teaching this like this here. And all of a sudden, the thing changed. And so they were writing. Froome was saying, how in the world this changed? And Froome going to lie and tell them all kind of stuff. We done changed. How you going to change something that God done put out? And there's letters there. And Stump went back there and got the letter and put it in his newsletter so you could see how the thing got changed. Boy, the devil is terrible. And unless you understand for yourself, you run the risk of being lost.
That's right.
Jesus paid it all.
That's right.
All to him we owe.
That's right.
Sin has left a crimson stain on everything, including us. But if we sit down with our Bible and the spirit of prophecy, the Lord will enlighten your head. And if you decide to follow the Lord, he will live in you and will abide with you and represent you in a place where you can't understand and know and see with your eyes, just like he did on the Day of Atonement on this earth. People couldn't see him, but they knew the high priest was in there in the most holy place. And they wanted to be sure that all their sins not only were forgiven, but were cleansed. See, there's a forgiving and there's a cleansing. And Jesus forgives and he cleanses. All of it was shown forth in the sanctuary. Thank God for the sanctuary. I believe in the sanctuary. I believe in Jesus. And I want him to be my high priest. If you want Jesus to live in you and you want him to be your high priest, put your hand up.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. May God bless us and keep us. And remember now, the things that are of the Spirit are of the Spirit. And when you let the Spirit live in you and abide with you, you can't go wrong. One more thing before I go. Now this comes from the original great controversy that Mrs. White wrote in 1858 in Locust Grove, Ohio. Now, when I say they were slick, they took this entire book and they put it in early writings. Now, you can find this in early writings, but it won't be under the, your head won't be in the mind of the great controversy between Christ and Satan. See, it's in early writings. That's still there, but it's in, yes, sir.
Gospel Workers.
Okay.
The two-volume book is Spiritual Gifts.
Oh, yeah.
Volume one is the same writing.
Right. See, but she first made it look like this when she first wrote it, before she put it in the spiritual gift, right. Okay, but let me read you what she wrote here. As the administrative of Jesus closed in the holy place, and he passed, no, that's not what I want. Hold it now. See, the devil is rough. A firm foundation. Here it is on page 168. I saw a company who stood well grounded and firm and would give no accountants to those who would unsettle the established faith of the body. God looked on them with approbation. Now she says this is what she saw. I was shown three steps.
That's right.
One, two, and three. The first, second, and third angel's messages. Said the angel, woe to him who shall move a block or stir a pen in these messages. They didn't mess with it. They didn't mess with it today. They have messed with the three angel messages. The true understanding of these messages is of vital importance. Now that rings a bell in my head. If something is important, then I must understand it and know it and believe it. The destiny of souls hangs upon the manner in which they are received. Now this is what she sees. I was again brought back through these messages and saw dearly the people of God who had purchased their experience. It had been obtained through suffering and severe conflict. Now she sees the importance of the three angels' message because it pertained to my soul salvation. And I ain't gonna understand it. No. I have to dig and study and read and pray to make sure that I understand the plan that God has laid down for me. There's too many ways that I'm seeing it. So again, I thank Stump for condensing it, making it plain, so all of us don't have no excuse. We can stand in front of God free with Christ living in us and abiding with us. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we thank you for your word and for Jesus, who gave us all that we might completely represent him. We ask that you would be in our midst, be with each one of us individually, and Lord, help us to understand your plan as you are in the antitypical day of atonement. Forgive us, live in us, abide with us, stay with us, make us one with you so that we might eternally live with you in eternal life. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.